Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Before I start my talk, I want to address one issue sort of head on, which is that if I know for some of you, hearing that I'm a scientist visiting from Eastern Massachusetts, from the Boston area, some of you are, you know, suspicious, possibly hostile already. I have nothing to do with the New England Patriots, nothing to do with the flag. It's not my fault. You know, please don't hate me for that reason. I do hope we have there's a good game tomorrow, and I will be rooting for the other, you know, the wrong team. But that's, you know, I'll be out of town by then. You can forget it. All right, so I'm here representing science, and as a geneticist, I'm going to talk about what I do for a living, which is what does genetics tell us about where humans came from? And the punchline is already just given away. If you want to sort of snooze to the science part, the answer is we got here through evolution. That's what biology says. That's what genetics says. The point of my talk is to try to explain to you what that means and a little bit of the reason why we think that's true. You don't have to believe me, but I wanted to just explain to you that we have reasons for thinking this. Before I start on the science, though, one word of caution, and I'm reiterating something that's been said repeatedly already. I'm talking here as a scientist, so I'm talking about physical processes. I'm talking about what science can tell us. And what science tells us is the physical process by which we got here. I'm not telling you what God's hand was in that process. That's not a question that science addresses. And as John said last night, just because we have a physical explanation for something doesn't mean God wasn't involved. And I've heard it, you know, a couple of times already, just even at lunch, that there's this repeated idea that if evolution is true, you know, if you've explained something by evolution, well, you're saying God didn't do it. And that is just false. That's a lie. So I'm not going to be talking about God here because that's not my job, but I'm talking about the science, but the two are not incompatible. All right, so before I talk specifically about where we come from as humans, I want to explain a little bit about what we mean by evolution. Because if you watch movies or watch TV, you may get some really funny ideas about what evolution is. Especially if you have kids who play with Pokemon, or if you've watched X-Men movies. No. So anyway, so I'm going to go through give you a few examples of what we mean by evolution, what the important principles are. And I'm going to start with something that's very familiar to all of us, which is human beings and the fact that we come in different colors. Our skin has different shades. And, you know, we're all very familiar with this. The question is why? Well, it didn't take people a long time to figure out that our skin color tends to correlate with where our ancestors come from or where we live. People who live near the equator have dark skin, and people who live near the Arctic have much lighter skin. And this makes sense biologically. Obviously, if you live where there's a lot of sun, you want to have dark skin so you don't get sunburn or skin cancer. And it works the other way, too. If you live near the Arctic, you need sunlight to make vitamin D, and if you have dark skin, you can't make much vitamin D, so you're not going to be very healthy. So it makes sense that it's, you know, skin colors are distributed the way they are in the world. One important thing to note about this is a genetic feature. If I move to Nigeria tomorrow, I'll get a tan, I'll get a little bit darker, but I'm not going to turn dark brown. It's my skin color, basically, I inherited from my parents. So it's something that's in our genes, we pass it down, part of our heredity. So how did this happen? Well, we actually have a pretty good idea now. We know that thousands of years ago, Homo sapiens as a species was living only in Africa, and gradually, about 60,000 years ago, we think, started spreading out of Africa to other places, and other places where there was less light. And as they moved, lots of genetic changes were happening to them kind of all the time. And some of those changes affected their skin color. And some made their skin a little bit lighter, some made somebody's skin a little bit darker. And if you were someone who was had moved to Europe and you had a mutation that made one of these genetic changes that made your skin a little bit lighter, well, you would probably be healthier and you'd have more kids. And so those changes stuck in Europe. On the other hand, if you were someone in Africa who was moving into maybe even closer to the equator, changes that made your skin darker would be more useful, and they stuck too. And we actually know what a lot of those genetic changes were. So if we draw a little like family tree of some human populations, I have a Northern European population, East Asian, and West African. We can say that, well, they started as one population, and they split into different groups over these 60,000 years. And they, there they are, they changed. Am I up there? There I am. They changed color gradually over those thousands of years. And for a biologist, this is actually a case of evolution. We consider this evolution. It's evolution is a change in a population over time because of genetics. It's not very important evolution. It's kind of minor, but it is evolution, and it illustrates an important principle and one of the basic foundations of evolution, which is that populations change from generation to generation. They change genetically. They change their traits as a result. And they may not change very much in the span of time, but it's actually an important mental change of viewpoint, because as human beings, we tend to think of a species as a thing. There is the squirrel, all right? There may be some variation around the squirrel, but basically there's the squirrel, and it's always been a squirrel, and it's always gonna be a squirrel. To a biologist, the squirrels we see right now are a snapshot of where squirrels happen to be right now. And 1,000 years ago, squirrels were slightly different, and in another 1,000 years, squirrels will be, again, slightly different. Not much, just a little, but constantly changing over time. So that's the first thing I want you to take away about evolution. And I'd like to stop a little bit and maybe go into a little bit more detail about something I just said, which is that there were these changes, genetic changes, that happened in these populations. And what exactly do I mean? Well, the technical term for genetic change is mutation. That's what a mutation means, is any change in your DNA. Now, you've all seen the pictures of DNA. You've got the double helix, and it's the DNA that carries all the information, it's the parts list for making a human being. And the parts list is slightly different if you have light skin than dark skin, or if you're tall or short. So there are small differences, but basically it's a complete list of how to make a human being. So it's got all of our information in it, and we all carry it. And the important part, if you care about the details, important part is carried, information is carried in those rungs in the ladder. They're called bases. There are four of them, and the order that they have basically encodes information. And we can express it as a string of letters, basically. We can say this DNA, we can express that as, say, this string of letters in this case. And so that's the information that we're all carrying. That's our genetic information. And we pass that information on to our kids. And we inherit it from our parents, we pass it on to our kids. Only every time we pass it on, it changes just a little bit. Every human being that's born has roughly 70 new mutations, 70 little changes usually in their DNA. 70 sounds like it might be a lot. We've got billions of bases of DNA. So 70 is actually a tiny drop in an ocean there in all of the DNA we already have. But every generation, there's this little bit of change. And so when we ask specifically what happened, why did we get light skin? Like, my ancestors mostly come from Germany, so I have pretty light skin. I know at least one of those changes I know in great detail. My great, 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 whatever, grandparent, grandmother or grandfather, about 600 generations removed, a particular person at a particular time, was born with one kind of DNA and passed on a slightly different kind of DNA in a particular piece of their genome that's called a gene. The gene is named SLC24A5. Genes tend not to have very sexy names. But that's what it's called. And that particular person had that change. So what I know is that this was the genetic code that they were born with, the string in that gene. And this right here is what they passed on. You can see an overwhelming difference, right? You may not even be able to spot the difference. There is actually one letter, one base that's different between those two. An A changed to a T. And because of that, that child was born with lighter skin. That's not the only reason for lighter skin, but that's the single biggest change. It's about 30% of the reason that Europeans have light skin, was that one change. And I know that anyone in the room whose ancestors come from Europe, you all have the T in your genome too. in that gene, just as I do. Because we all had that same great-great-great-grandparent. We all descend from that one common ancestor. And if your ancestors came from East Asia, say, or Australia, or Africa, you have the A there, because that's what you inherited from your ancestor. So I want you to learn two more things about evolution here from this. One is that while changes happen over time, genetically, that's what's going on in populations, each of us carries the record of those changes in our DNA. In every cell in our body, I carry the record of something that happened 15,000 years ago to a particular person, which is remarkable that there's this tremendous history written inside each of us. Eventually, that record gets overwritten by new mutations, but that takes a very long time. And the second principle to remember is that if we share a change, if a bunch of us do, it's because we share an ancestor. One of our ancestors had that change, and so we all share that. Okay, so that's human beings, and that's evolution, but that's a really superficial change. Skin color is skin deep. And actually, it turns out that that's one of the biggest differences between human groups is in skin color. Mostly, we're very similar to each other. We're all the same species. We're all very similar to each other. So as evolution goes, that's not very exciting or very controversial. So the question is, what happens if the process keeps going? And suppose the process kept going for 10 times as long, not 60,000 years, but 600,000 years. Well, we can look at a different species for that, or a different couple of species. Let's look at bears. About 600,000 years ago, we're pretty sure, there was a species of bear in North America, and they split into two. And one branch became what we now know as the brown bears, that includes grizzly bears, and the other branch became polar bears. They moved north, and actually kind of like people, their fur got lighter because it was useful for them. And it wasn't just a change in color. Obviously, you know, polar bears have a very different lifestyle. They live on the ice or in the water. They hunt in the water. They're quite different. They're obviously recognizably still bears, but they're different. And they're different enough that we call them different species now. And they have official Latin names that I don't know for whatever they are. They're still closely enough related that they can mate and produce offspring. This is what the result of interbreeding between a grizzly bear and a polar bear looks like, and that's a kind of a funky looking bear. It's the main reason for showing that picture. That's a weird bear. It's stuffed in a museum somewhere. Somebody shot it. But it happens, but it doesn't happen very often. They're basically distinct organisms now. So the fourth rule I want you to learn here is that as this process continues of populations changing, if the populations stay separate for long enough, eventually they can become new species and distinct, and they become increasingly different. All right, one more example on evolution, and this one's from a bird. This is a finch, it's actually a rose finch, and we have good evidence that about 5 million years ago, now we're talking millions of years, about 5 million years ago, a flock of finches, very closely related to rose finches, probably got blown off course, but in any case, ended up on one of the islands in Hawaii. We know it couldn't be longer ago than that because the Hawaiian Islands are only about 5 or 6 million years old. They're volcanoes, they appeared in the middle of the Pacific, far away from everything, and so that was when they had to have gotten there. And it turned out to be a good place for birds to arrive because there weren't any other land birds at the time because these were pretty new islands. And when they got there, they stuck around. And as I've been describing, they also split into multiple species and split again and split again. And over these 5 million years, they ended up becoming at least 50-some different species, possibly more. Most of them are extinct now. A lot of the other ones that survive are becoming extinct rapidly, unfortunately. But they became quite different from each other. These are known as the Hawaiian honey creepers. They're all closely related to each other and to other finches, but you can see they're very different. They have different shapes, different colors, different sizes. Their beaks look different, and their beaks look different because they live on different things. Some of them eat seeds, some of them drink nectar. This is the kind of change that we can see over millions of years. And so the final principle is that the process I'm talking about doesn't stop. A species changes, splits into two, they change, they become new species, and it just keeps going on and on. To correct something John Walton said, I think it was John who said something about 5,000 species of beetles. There are actually a million species of beetles. This process can really get carried away. There are a lot of beetles in the world. So this is the point I want to make about evolution. These are the things I want you to learn. And so what do biologists think about humans? How does this apply to humans? Well, we think it applies to humans, and that the same process has produced us. In particular, we have evidence that about 6 million years ago, roughly the same time those finches were landing on Hawaii, give or take a million years, you know, there was a species of ape in Africa, and it split into two. And one of those branches eventually became humans. And the other branch became chimpanzees. And like the birds, there are still a lot of similarities between humans and chimpanzees, which, you know, if you've ever seen a chimpanzee in the zoo or on TV or whatever, you know, our shape is basically the same. You know, they don't have a tail. They have fingernails, which most animals don't, just like us. They've got thumbs. But there are also big differences. We walk upright. We have less hair, in some cases even, you know, less than others. And obviously, we've got really, really big brains. So chimpanzees don't sit around and have conferences and talk about where they came from. We do. We can worry about things. So, you know, there are dramatic differences between us, but we're still recognizably they're most similar to us out of in all of the animal kingdom. And if you go back further in time, well, we have other cousins. The gorilla is most a little bit closely related to us. It's a couple million years further back in time. And to shrink that down, we can look at more of our family tree. Well, orangutans are off on the side, and then monkeys, there are hundreds of species of monkey. And even a little bit more distantly related are the lemurs from Madagascar. And then our sort of less savory relatives, rodents, you know, rats, we're related to rats and mice. Also the cute ones, you know, we're also related to hamsters, that's okay. And you know, even further back, now we're talking 100 million years ago, I'm not even sure what the time is, a long time. Bats, cows. You can go back even further in time to crocodiles and eventually plants. But I don't think the real issue for most people isn't, you know, are bats related to pineapples? We're really interested, are humans, where did humans come from? Are humans related to monkeys or not? And so that's the part I'm really gonna focus on. Now this picture was worked out by biologists without the help of genetics mostly. Some of the details genetics has helped with, but the basic idea was accepted and the real structure of the tree here was understood long before we could look at the genetics. Since in the last several decades, we now have the capacity to look directly at the DNA, directly not at what the superficial stuff is, but what's in the instructions, what's going on underneath the hood on each of these species, and so we can see in detail, rather than just guessing, we can see the connections between them. And if what I was saying before is correct, that we will have inherited things from our past, we should see that in our DNA. And that's what we do see. I'm going to give just two examples of how, as geneticists, we see traces of evolution in our DNA. I'm going to talk in some detail about both of them. So you just have to sit through two examples. And the first is a case of a missing gene. This is a gene that humans don't have. And what's interesting about this is the way we don't have it. And this story starts with scurvy, the disease scurvy. And when the age of exploration started, and long sea voyages, people started going on long sea voyages for months at a time, they noticed something, which was that after a month or two at sea, sailors started to get sick. They started to get weaker, lethargic, bruised easily, eventually their teeth would fall out, and they'd die. In short, they had scurvy. Scurvy had been, was known before, it was described thousands of years ago, but it was much more serious on sailing ships. It happened a lot. In fact, it's been estimated that more than 2 million sailors died from scurvy over the several centuries of the age of sail. And what's kind of odd, though, is if they had taken any of a whole bunch of other animals along on these sea voyages, those other animals would be just fine. You know, if you took a horse along and you want to go exploring with a horse when you got somewhere, the horse wouldn't get scurvy. He'd be okay. We now know why that's the case. It turns out that scurvy is a vitamin deficiency disease. You get scurvy because you don't have enough vitamin C. And the food that sailors ate, hardtack and salt pork, does not have much vitamin C. So after a month or two, your body runs out of vitamin C and you get sick. And we need vitamin C because we don't make vitamin C ourselves in our bodies. We lack that capacity. It happens to be a failure that we share with, say, orangutans and monkeys and various other higher primates. Most animals, though, can make their own vitamin C. So if a horse was along, he's happy because he has a way of making vitamin C. And there's a very specific difference in humans and other higher primates that keeps us from making vitamin C. And there's one enzyme you need to make vitamin C. There's this whole biochemical machinery that's required. All the rest of it is present in humans. It does other things. But there's this one enzyme that's needed to take the final chemical product of that and turn it into vitamin C. And we don't have that enzyme, and neither do monkeys. But dogs do, and cats do. So as a geneticist, when I look at this, and I look at, well, what are these animals that can't make vitamin C, including us? Well, they're all clustered together in one branch of this family tree that I say we belong to. And as a geneticist, I think, well, that we share that trait because something happened back there in our ancestor. We inherited the same failure from all of these different species inherited the same failure that somehow makes us not able to digest, generate this enzyme. So that's an idea, it's a hypothesis, but it's something we can investigate because we have DNA now and we can go look for this enzyme. And so if you look in, say, a mouse, you will find this enzyme, the gene for this enzyme that codes for this enzyme. The gene is called GULO. The actual official name is L-gulonolactone oxidase, which is why we mostly just call it GULO. It's a little long. And I've given a cartoon version of it there. There are 11 chunks of DNA that are important for making the enzyme. They carry the information. There's some filler DNA in between them that doesn't matter. So those black blocks are the important part of the DNA. It's about 100 base pairs for each of those blocks. And if you then, so you know what this gene should look like, if you then go look in the human DNA and say, well, do we have that gene? The answer is yeah, sort of. We've got pieces of the gene. We still have five of those blocks are left, but the rest are missing. And this is what's called a pseudogene, because it's got the form of a gene. It probably used to be a gene, but something happened to it, and it's no longer functional. So you have bits of a gene left. In fact, what probably happened was large mutations, deletions of big chunks of DNA happened repeatedly and left us with the fragments of a gene. As I said, it's called a pseudogene. It's a false gene. All right, so that explains why we can't make vitamin C and why we lack this enzyme. How about our relatives, the other primates? What is their gene? Do they have the gene at all? Well, you can look for that too. And if you look, you'll find that, well, chimpanzees are missing exactly the same pieces. And monkeys, this is a particular monkey, it's called a macaque, rhesus macaque, it's missing the same pieces too. And what that's telling me is that the reason all of us can't make this enzyme is that we all have the same problem. The same damage happened to the gene, and that's because we all inherited it from that one common ancestor, one species, where that happened. Something bad happened. Presumably that happened in a species that had a lot of vitamin C in their diet, because otherwise they would have been sick and it wouldn't have gotten to us. So that's the kind of thing we expect to see, and that's the kind of thing we do see when we look in detail. And this immediately lets us make, a prediction. Ah, yes, we should be able to make a prediction here, which is that any primate, any of these higher primates, any monkey species we look at should be missing the same pieces of gene. They might be missing some more because other mutations might have happened, but we all should have inherited those same failures. And most, we haven't looked at most of these species, so this is a pretty strong prediction. We could go look at any monkey species and check this. And I made this slide about a month ago while I was on a plane flying for the vacation with my family. And I said, all right, great, you know, we should be able, we could test this. If somebody wanted to go out, they could test it. And I realized, wait, I can test this. We have the complete sequence of the gorilla. And nobody's, I've never seen anybody look for this gene in the gorilla. So why don't we go, why don't I go look to see what the gene looks like in gorillas? And so I did while I was on vacation. My family was out puttering around in the water. I went online, and it turns out the entire, all of these genomes are online, and there are search tools. So give me 20 minutes, I could explain to you how to go do this search yourself, and you can have a lot of fun, possibly depending on what you think is fun. Anyway, so if you look at the gorilla genome, which I did, you find, yes, it is indeed missing the same pieces. In fact, if you look at even in real detail, if you look at that second block there, it turns out, that second black block, it turns out humans only have about half of that block. We've lost a couple chunks off of that block too. Gorillas are missing almost all of that. There's only maybe 10% left. I forget how much, 10 or 15% left of that block. So I think additional mutations have happened in the gorillas, but the mutations that we were talking about before, they are there too. So that prediction was, in fact, accurate. So I like that. I like predictions that work, especially since I made the trouble of, you know, went to the trouble of looking it up myself. All right, so that's a nice simple story, but there are some complications. It turns out it's not just primates who can't make vitamin C. There are some other species, guinea pigs, for example, and some bat species. Now, if you look at our family tree again, well, the guinea pigs are off there on the left in blue, and I've just stuck in a random blue line among the bats. They're not part of our branch. Most rodents can make vitamin C just fine, and so, you know, guinea pigs should not be able to have inherited that those same set of mutations. That these should be different. And so that gives us another prediction, which is that if you look at that same gene, or the same chain of genes in these other species, they should be damaged in different ways. There should be different reasons because they're not part of our local family branch. We couldn't have inherited the same thing as them. And you can do that search too, and I did. And you discover, yeah, the guinea pig gene mostly is actually, most of it's still there. It's not missing most of the same pieces. It did not inherit those same damaging mutations. I'm just only showing you the big mutations that destroyed big chunks. There are also a bunch of smaller mutations, like single bases have changed, and some of them also would damage the gene. And if you look at those, they're quite different than the ones present in humans or chimpanzees. So that's another prediction that is fulfilled. So that's the kind of thing, again, we like to see. And there's even, you can even go deeper. This is a little bit subtle and sort of extra credit. If you don't want to pay attention to this, don't. What happens if a gene stops functioning, it's now a pseudogene? Well, mutations are happening all the time. You know, not every generation, but sometimes mutations will happen to that gene. And if you're an organism, an animal that depends on that gene, if you need this enzyme to make vitamin C, or otherwise you're gonna get sick, well then, if you get that mutation, you're gonna be sick and you're not gonna pass that on to your kids. So bad mutations in functioning genes tend to get weeded out. They don't accumulate. And a pseudogene, on the other hand, nobody cares. The gene already doesn't work, so the mutation just gets passed down. So one of the things we expect to see is that mutations, damaging mutations, should accumulate faster in pseudogenes. And you can look at the number of mutations that have accumulated in humans, besides those big ones, just look, you know, within the parts we still have left. How many mutations are there? And you can compare that to some other branch where the gene is still functioning, in this case, the lemur branch. Some of the researchers looked at an animal called a sugar baby, I believe, and looked at their copy of the gene. And they counted the number of mutations present, and if you compare them, you will see that, yeah, there are a lot more mutations have accumulated in our line than in this, the other line where it worked, 50 mutations rather than 13 mutations. So again, it leads us, I have a handy summary here. Why we like this as a kind of good scientific explanation, because it explains the patterns we see, evolution here, just meaning that we share common ancestors, explains the patterns we see. It lets us make predictions and then go test them, and they work. That's really important. It also raises other kinds of questions that turn out to be fruitful, that wouldn't have necessarily occurred to us otherwise. Like, why should we be carrying sugar baby mutations with human mutations? Well, we have an idea. We have a framework for asking questions. And so this is the kind of thing that makes this a productive scientific theory and why we like it. That's the end of my first example, a brief break from genetics. I'm just going to pose a question for you, which is, why do we as human beings get goosebumps? We know mechanically what happens. Every one of our hair follicles has a tiny little muscle attached to it. And when we're cold or scared or hear something's awe-inspiring, those muscles pull up our hairs. And that's okay, but why? It doesn't actually do anything, at least for most of us who don't have a lot of hair, it doesn't actually do anything to raise our hair when we're scared or when we're cold. All it's doing, that's a lot of machinery that has no obvious purpose. And so my question for you is, why do we get goosebumps? And I'm not gonna answer that question, I'll just let you answer it yourself, think about it. Instead, I'm gonna turn to my second example, which is quite different in a way. This is an example of viruses that are present in our DNA. These are relics of old viruses, old viral infections that we carry around in our DNA as humans. And this story starts with retroviruses. You may have heard of retroviruses. The most famous retrovirus is HIV, that causes AIDS, obviously very familiar. Retroviruses, like any virus, a retrovirus invades a cell in the host, say in this case a human. What's distinctive about a retrovirus is it has its own genes. It copies them and inserts it directly into the DNA of the host. So if it invades a cell, it sticks its own DNA into the cell's DNA, and becomes part of that DNA. And that DNA is the instructions for making more viruses. So it basically turns the cell into a factory for making viruses. But sometimes the virus isn't active and can just sit there in the DNA, and it's just part of that cell's DNA. That may not be very good for the cell, but it isn't of very great interest to evolutionary biology. I have a little illustration here. You probably don't need this, but if that was our DNA before, along comes the virus with about 10,000 bases of its own DNA, and it sticks it in there. So now the cell is carrying this DNA as part of itself. So that's not very interesting unless the cell that gets invaded happens to be a sperm or an egg cell, or one of the cells that lead up to them. Because now this new DNA can get passed on to another generation. It's just sitting there as part of your DNA, and so you can pass it on to your kids. And it just sits there. And so this is now it's a unique event because this is a particular strain of virus that invaded in a very particular place in the DNA. As I said, there are billions of bases of DNA. The odds that the same virus would invade the same site twice in two different people is vanishingly small. So if you see two people who have that same inserted virus there, that they got it from the same ancestor. And we do indeed see that in people. People carry, we do indeed find these viruses. It's very easy to tell them too, because it's virus is not the sort of DNA you find in our cells normally. All right, and there's one other thing that can happen, because this DNA that's inserted is the instructions for making viruses. Well, as it gets passed on from generation to generation, sometimes that virus, that DNA makes more viruses and infects someplace else in the DNA. So what can happen is, maybe your grandchild will get a new insertion someplace else in their DNA. You can end up with multiple copies of the same virus sort of scattered through your DNA. And that makes it an interesting tool for looking to see what happened in history, because these are things that get passed down over and over. And people have looked at these, naturally, researchers. And here I've once again drawn the family tree, a little bit slightly different shape now. That's us there next to the chimpanzees. And we've got gorillas and orangutans, and what else do I have there? Oh, yeah, gibbons. And I split out old world monkeys, like African monkeys, and monkeys from the New World, because they're more distantly related, the New World ones. And people looked, so some researchers looked at a particular family of viruses, to see if there were copies in the human genome that were just sitting there as part of our DNA. And yeah, they found some. Like they found one on our seventh chromosome that is present in humans. Well, that's not very interesting. It just shows that viruses do indeed make these insertions. But and so we say, all right, it inserted. More interesting is that they found the same virus in the same place in humans, chimpanzees, and gorillas. Well, this is a little bit like the broken gene. We share this, we share the same insertion into the same place in our DNA, and the easiest explanation for that is, well, it happened because it happened somewhere back there, a particular animal had that got sick with this virus, and it stuck itself into their DNA, and we've all inherited the same DNA from them. And you can go on. They found more viruses, some that spanned across all the way to gibbon, and some that were also found in old world monkeys, or all monkeys. And we say that had to have happened a long time ago in an ancestor far in the past. And altogether, they looked at, it was 14 different viruses that they found present in humans. Three of them were found only in humans. Two were found in humans, chimpanzees, and gorillas. A couple were found also in orangutans, one they weren't sure whether it was in gibbons or not. Three were definitely also in gibbons. And then there were a couple that were found in all of the old world, and a couple that were also found in new world monkeys. So these had to have been very old ones. What they never found was something like this, something that was present in a human and also in a gibbon in the same place, or present in a human and in an old world monkey. Because that would have required that the same virus insert in the same place two different times. And that just didn't happen. So in none of these cases did they see that, even though there were lots of opportunity, lots of ways, lots of combinations that could have occurred that way. So they didn't see that. So the pattern we see is exactly what we would expect to see if indeed we inherit these viruses from distant ancestors and that we share that inheritance with other primates. It would be nice, though, to be able to confirm that. And we can. Now, a virus that's shared with a bunch of monkeys, say, had to have happened a long time ago. Based on what paleontologists tell us, it was at least 25 million years ago. On the other hand, a virus that is found only in humans has to be less than 5 million years old, because otherwise we'd see it in chimpanzees, too. And if the virus has been sitting in our DNA for 5 million years versus 25 million years, that whole time it's been accumulating mutations. Mutations have been happening to it. As I said, mutations just happen. So is there a way that we can find out how many mutations have occurred in these viruses, and so see whether they're really younger or older? Well, there is. It's a little bit complicated, but not too. These are different strains of viruses, the ones that are present only in modern humans and the ones that are old. And what you can do, I told you before that you can get lots of copies of the same virus in the genome, in your DNA. Well, if you get lots of copies and they all sit there for 25 million years and get passed down, they're all going to get different mutations. They're going to accumulate different mutations, and they're going to get more and more different as time goes on. So what you can do is look within each strain and see how different are the viruses, the viral insertions in that strain. And you just say there, compare them to other copies. And so you can measure. If it's young, they should all be very similar to each other. And so when you look at the viruses that we carry that are only seen in humans, we see they're about 2% different from each other. On the other hand, if you look at ones that are a little bit older, well, they're a little bit more different from each other. And you can guess what the pattern's like. As you look at things that are shared across more species, the viruses that are present are more and more different from each other. And it goes all the way back. The oldest ones are about 10 or 12% different from each other. And so this is a nice confirmation that this DNA that came from viruses has actually been sitting in passed down from generation to generation, accumulating mutations for a very long time. And that's a kind of confirmation of the pattern we were expecting to see. And again, this is the kind of thing we see over and over again in genetics, is we expect stuff based on common descent, based on evolution, explains what we see, we make predictions, and the predictions are fulfilled. I'm going to pause there. That's the evidence about where we came from. I'm going to make a little digression here onto what about Adam and Eve? Because this is a conference about Genesis, Adam and Eve are in Genesis. What does genetics tell us about Adam and Eve? What information can it provide? In particular, can genetics tell us whether we descend from a single pair of people? Now, there are Christians for whom this is not a live issue. They don't consider Adam and Eve to be historical figures, and that's fine. That's not an issue for them. But if you do consider them to be historical figures, what can genetics say? And so did we descend from a single pair? Well, it turns out it depends on exactly what you mean by that question. It's undoubtedly true that sometime in the last few thousand years, there was a pair of human beings that everyone in this room, everyone on the entire planet, could trace their genealogy back to. If you had a complete genealogical tree, that pair would be in everyone's tree. That's pretty much inevitable, just given the number of ancestors you have as you go back. And we only have two parents, we've got four grandparents, and it doubles every generation. And after not too many generations, you get a whole lot of ancestors, and eventually everybody shares some of them. So and people have done the calculation. They say, within the last few thousand years, everybody on the planet is descended from some pair of people. So if you're of the school of interpretation that says, well, maybe Adam and Eve were evolved, but God took two people, but as part of a larger group, but took two people to be special representatives, that's entirely consistent with what we see of genetics. And it could have happened any time, as I say, beyond a couple thousand years. On the other hand, if you mean, was there a time when there was just that one pair of people? Well, now we can say no, not recently anyway. While we all share one set of distant ancestors, there were lots of other people who were alive at the same time. And if there had been just a single pair of people, that would also leave very clear signatures in our current genetics. If you compare the genetic variation in different people, they all would have had to come from the genes carried by just that pair of people. And that's actually, it would be extremely easy to see. I'm not going to go into details to explain how we can do that, but we can, just looking at the kinds of variants we see in comparing in different people, we can estimate how big the human population was at different times in the past. And we can go back pretty far. This is a figure from a paper, it was actually written by one of my office mates, I think, at the time. Going to the right is going back in time, back to a million years, from 10,000 years to a million years ago. And it's an estimate of how big the human population was based on looking at some genetic data. And the conclusion from that is it was never smaller than about 5,000 people. At any point, there may have been, we have a particular pair that we descended from, sure, but there were lots of other people alive at the same time. Now, I don't think that's very reliable back to a million years. There's large errors on that. Beyond half a million years, I'm not so sure, but certainly in the last few hundred thousand years, what we see in genetics is inconsistent with there having been such a small population. We also actually know this independently. We now know that everybody who's not entirely from African descent, so Europeans, Asians, Native Americans, we all have a little bit of Neanderthal DNA in us. You may have seen this in the newspaper, about 2% Neanderthal. Well, Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, they lived on different continents and they were separated for about half a million years. So I know that 300,000 years ago, I had ancestors who were Neanderthals living in Europe. I also had ancestors who were on their way to becoming Homo sapiens in Africa. And so at no point in that last 500,000 years did we have just that one, did I just have one pair of ancestors. Our ancestry is complex and involves a lot of ancestors. So that, I think, is the framework, the limits within that genetics can tell us about Adam and Eve and about how you interpret Genesis. All right, I want to sum up now. And I gave you two examples. Talked about a single pseudogene, the one that keeps us from making vitamin C. And I think that's, it's very consistent with what we expect to see from evolution. Lets us make nice predictions, but it's just a single case. But it turns out there are actually 20,000 pseudogenes in each of us. We carry that many in our DNA. And so there are, you can look not at one pseudogene, but you can look over and over again. And nobody's looked at all of them, but they've looked at a fair number of them. And when you do, you see the same kinds of patterns. You see the patterns we expect from common descent, from evolution. Sometimes the story's a little more complicated, sometimes it's really simple, but you see the same story again and again. And this, you know, I told you about, there was this study of 14 different places where retroviruses had stuck themselves into our DNA. We actually have 200,000 copies of retroviruses in our DNA. They're all over the place. So you can look at all of those again and again, and once again, you see the same thing. And there are lots of other things you can look at. There are 500,000 cases of another kind of element that moves around and copies itself in our DNA. All of these things let us look at what has happened in the past and what would we be expecting to see if evolution is true. And we see it over and over again that this is the kind of pattern we see. So I'm concluding with a quotation here from a famous 20th century geneticist, Theodosius Dobzhansky. This is a widely quoted quotation, especially that first line, which is that nothing in biology makes sense except in light of evolution. And here he goes on to say, basically, without evolution, biology is stamp collecting. Interesting little things, tidbits, but there's no overall picture. With evolution, suddenly it becomes a jigsaw puzzle and everything fits together and makes a coherent picture, and it makes sense. And that's the case. And that's why scientists use evolution. It's not because scientists are out to get rid of God or because there's, you know, some atheist bias. It's because it works. Scientists are very pragmatic people, and we use what works. In my line of work, our ultimate goal is to understand and cure disease. And that's what we're dedicated to. But we still spend a lot of money and a lot of time studying evolution because it's such a useful tool and it tells us so much about how we got here and about what's going on in genes. So that's the important message. There's another line in this essay that Dobzhansky wrote that isn't as widely quoted, and I wanted to include that. In it, he says, "It is wrong to hold creation and evolution as mutually exclusive alternatives. I'm a creationist and an evolutionist. Creation is not an event that happened in 4004 BC. It's a process that began some 10 billion years ago and is still underway." Because he wanted to leave two messages. One is the evidence for evolution is really overwhelming. And the two is it does not rule out a creator. It's entirely consistent. He believed in a creator. And that was the message he wanted to leave. And that's the message I want to give you too. So that's my conclusion. I just want to note that I didn't realize there was somebody going to be somebody here from BioLogos. I want to put in a plug, particularly for articles by Dennis Venema at biologos.org, their website. He's a biologist. He knows his genetics. He goes into much more detail than I have, and possibly much clearer, I don't know, on this entire, all of this, these subjects about where we come from, how many people there were. So I suggest if you want to look any more, you know, read books, but start with that. That's a good place to look. So thank you.